Well, I think we can start already. If you are agree, then it's my pleasure to present you the talk by Professor Alexander Bendikov from the Institute of Mathematics from Wroclaw University. And he will speak about the spectrum of the hierarchical Schrodinger-type operator. So please.
Okay. Thank you very much for the invitation to deliver my talk on this conference. So the subject of my talk is, I am going to talk about spectrum of the hierarchical Schrodinger-type operator. And this is the case of locally bounded potentials. This is joint project. This is joint project. Schrodinger type operators acting on the Cantor-like sets. And this project is joined with Professor Grigor'yan from Bielefeld University and Professor Molchanov from University, North Carolina University at Charlotte. Okay. So the concept of hierarchical Laplacian is going back to the school of Bogolyubov. And this concept has been used by Dyson and his collaborators in his construction of the fuzzy transition of 1D ferromagnetic model with long-range interaction. So here I put two famous papers. This is, first of all, Dyson. Can you see this paper? In communication of mathematical physics. And Professor Molchanov, this is already application to Anderson model. So this is Schrodinger operator. The notion then, a little bit later, the notion of the hierarchical Laplacian acting on a general ultrametric space was developed to the high level of generality in my paper joint with Professor Grigor'yan, Pite, and Vyot. And it was published in Russian Mathematical Service 6 years ago. In my survey, also hit kernels for isotropic-like Markov generators on ultrametric spaces. So I would like also to mention here very closely related works of Vladimirov, Volovich, and Zelenov, and Kochubey. In the case when the fuzzy space is a field of periodic numbers. Okay, so let me explain you in the simplest case the Dyson dyadic model. In this model, the hierarchical Laplacian is realized as a self-adjoint integral operator acting in L2 on semi-axis. More precisely, let me explain you the structure. So first of all, we consider semi-axis and consider the family of partitions of the semi-axis. And each partition, called this PR, is made of dyadic intervals. Here I show the dyadic interval. Okay. And we call the number R the rank of the partition, respectively the rank of the dyadic interval. So we have the family of all possible dyadic intervals. Let me note that any point X belongs to exactly one interval. Call this interval ER of X, of rank R. And the whole set semi-axis is union of the increasing family of dyadic intervals around X. Next, I would like to introduce the hierarchical distance. This distance or metric between X and Y is defined as Lebesgue measure. I denote this absolute value of I of the minimal dyadic interval which contains both X and Y. So one can check that this quantity satisfies the so-called ultrametric inequality. You see, d of x, y less or equal than maximum of d, x, z.
I'm sorry, but your presentation just disappeared because Miodrag Matilevich started to share his screen. Please unshare your screen, Professor Matilevich.
Okay, I'm waiting.
Could you share your screen now, Professor Bendikov, please?
What does it mean, share my screen?
You did it once. So there is a button for that. Where they say more actions.
Share. You can... window. Here we are, share, and...
Okay, thank you. And now your presentation.
Do you see my presentation?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, so should I repeat?
No, it was just a second ago.
Okay, so this is an introduction of hierarchical structure. So yes. We have partition of semi-axis, and this is the partition of semi-axis by dyadic intervals. Okay, and then any point belongs to exactly one interval, and the hierarchical distance between X and Y is defined as Lebesgue measure of the interval I of the minimal dyadic interval, which contains both X and Y. One can show that this quantity satisfies the so-called ultrametric inequality. You see X, Y, and intermediate point Z. So you have this, you see this inequality. D of x, y less or equal maximum of d x, z and d z, y. Well, this is ultrametric inequality, and it is stronger than triangle inequality. So, let me list some important properties of this ultrametric. This is, of course, metric, but this is more strong metric than so the Euclidean metric and this ultrametric, they define topologies which are not equivalent. Indeed, by the very definition, the ultrametric moderates the Euclidean metric, right? Because its length of minimal dyadic interval. Next, on the other hand, if you take point a little bit from left side, from one and to one, it will be always for any epsilon two. It is easy to see. So, and the Euclidean metric is very small. So this shows that these two metrics are not equivalent at all. Nevertheless, the couple semi-axis X and ultrametric is a complete locally compact and non-compact and separable metric space. one can show that in this metric space, the set of all open balls coincides with the set of all dyadic intervals. Very strange property, unusual for the Euclidean metric. Moreover, each open ball is a closed compact set. And each point or A of ball B can be regarded as its center. Any two balls either do not intersect, or one is a subset of another. This shows that the couple XZ is a proper, totally disconnected metric space. In particular, this metric space is homeomorphic to the Cantor set with punctured point. The Borel sigma algebra in this metric space generated by the ultrametric balls coincides with the classical Borel sigma algebra generated by the Euclidean metric. Next, I would like to introduce the hierarchical Laplacian. Well, what I mean Laplacian? So in potential theory Laplacian, usually this is a generator of some Markov semigroup. So in this time, I'm going to build some generator of Markov semigroup. So let D be the set of all compactly supported, locally constant functions. And kappa be a parameter. By the way, the set of all compactly supported and locally constant functions in ultrametric, this is a set of continuous functions. And this set belongs to all spaces, Banach spaces of continuous functions and functions of integrable functions. Now I am going to introduce hierarchical Laplacian. So the hierarchical Laplacian, this is operator which acts in L2 and formally is written as a sum of minus Markov generators of pure jump processes. Here it is written, you see, sum, there are coefficients here, and this is elementary Laplacian, which people call jump process, generator of jump process. So maybe it's time to recall you the notion of jump process. This is important class of Markov processes. So here is definition. A Markov process is called a jump, a pure jump process, if starting from any point X, it has all sample passes constant, except for isolated jumps, and all its passes are right continuous. The basic data which define the process are a function lambda and a Markov kernel, which satisfies this natural condition. Intuitively, a particle starting from X remains there for an exponentially distributed time with parameter lambda of X, at which time it jumps to a new position X prime according to the distribution U of X, etc. This is very important class of Markov processes. So these are Markov processes without small jumps. Okay. Now, as each elementary Laplacian lambda r can be written as integral operator with kernel. You see, now this function intensivity does not depend on x. It depends on rank of partition. And Markov kernel, this is just uniform distribution in the two-adic interval. So that means that particle from X jumps to new position, and at this position it is uniformly distributed in the interval IR. So because we have sum of elementary Laplacians, so the operator L can be represented as hypersingular integral operator. One can compute the corresponding, the so-called jump kernel. So here are our computations. So by the way, the operator alpha is called spectral dimension generated by hierarchical Laplacian. Now let's talk about spectrum of the hierarchical Laplacian. It is very simple spectrum. To each dyadic interval, we can associate the Haar function. This is Haar function. Norm at Haar function, its norm in L2 equals to 1. One can prove that Haar function is an eigenfunction of the operator L subject to the eigenvalue kappa raised to power r. So we have already found countably many eigenvalues of operator L. So as we know, So by the way, each eigenvalue has infinite multiplicity. So the spectrum of this operator is not discrete at all. As the set of Haar function forms a complete orthonormal basis in L2, the operator L is symmetric, and it is essentially self-adjoint operator, and its spectrum is pure point. Okay, this is first conclusion. Now, well, this is minus Markov generator, and it would be natural to consider evolution generated by this operator. So we would like to compute its Markov semigroup. Okay, this is symmetric semigroup, and one can prove that this semigroup admits a continuous heat kernel. So that means that each operator e raised to power minus til L is an integral operator with integral kernel which depends on t, x, and y. Sometimes people call this kernel the fundamental solution of the parabolic equation with non-local operator L. And what is interesting is that thanks to very exact form of eigenvalues and eigenfunctions, one can estimate the heat kernel in the following way. You see, this bound is very remind us estimates of stable densities in the Euclidean case. It looks like asymptotic of stable density, but with ultrametric D instead of Euclidean metric. So the heat kernel is a continuous function in the ultrametric D, but it is not continuous function at all in the Euclidean metric. And it can be easily seen from the precise formula for the heat kernel. So PTXY can be expressed as a semi-Laplace transform of some function n. There exists here D star. This is equivalent to D metric, which is intrinsically related to the operator L. And N is a so-called spectral function. As D star and Euclidean metric are not comparable, so this function, it is easy to see that this function is not continuous in the Euclidean metric, but it is even Lipschitz in the ultrametric. Here is behavior of this function of the heat kernel on the diagonal set is very important in some spectral problems. This is so-called trace of Shubin of this operator. One can show that this quantity does not depend on X. And even so, one can find asymptotic relation. So this Shubin trace, you see, looks like trace for classical stable generator. But here there is quantity, which is periodic function of in the scale of log t. So one can show that Shubin trace is not even a regular Eurian function, in contrary to the Euclidean case. Okay. The Tablison-Vladimirov multiplier. It is remarkable that the hierarchical Laplacian introduced above can be identified with the so-called Tablison-Vladimirov multiplier, which acts in L2 on the field of two odic numbers. That means precisely that this is operator. So if we take Fourier transform, then it looks like multiplication operator. And this is two odic norm. In particular, minus d alpha is a symmetric alpha stable generator acting on the abelian group Q2, whose heat kernel can be estimated as follows. And this is the point where Dyson's model and theory of Vladimirov and Tablison meet each other. So it is important to find identification of Dyson's hierarchical semi-axis and the field of toadic numbers. It can be done using some topological tools. Now Schrodinger-type operator. Well, if you have some operator L, then you can consider some special perturbation of operator L by by multiplicator. This is multiplication by function V, which we assume locally bounded function. So it is easy to see, because we assume that V is locally bounded function, that the operator H is well defined on the set D of locally constant functions with compact support. So it is densely defined symmetric operator acting in L2. Let us list some important properties of this so-called Schrödinger-type operator. Actually, some people call this operator Anderson operator. If L is a Dyson operator, then perturbation of Dyson operator, this is Anderson operator. Okay, anyway. So first property is that operator H, a perturbation of operator L, is essentially self-adjoint operator. Well, this is actually a very general statement. In the classical case, this is not true at all. So if you want to create essentially self-adjoint operator with Laplacian in RD, then essential self-adjointness of H does not hold in general. And this is famous Sears theorem. For instance, if we take potential x raised to power gamma, then there is a continuum of self-adjoint extensions of such operator. Moreover, in this one-dimensional case, due to result to Cotani, the spectrum of the Schrödinger operator may contain non-trivial, absolutely continuous, and singular continuous paths. This statement for hierarchical Laplacian is not known yet, and it would be very interesting to describe potentials V which create operator with continuous, absolutely continuous, or singular continuous paths. Okay, so at present writing, this is an open problem. Second property, if potential goes to infinity, at infinity, then the operator H has a compact resolvent. So it's a more or less understandable in the general theory of perturbations of operators. So that means that spectrum of H is discrete. If potential goes to zero at infinity, then essential spectrum of H coincides with the spectrum of L, with the essential spectrum of L. And we know exactly spectrum of L. So in particular, spectrum of H is pure point, and the negative part of the spectrum consists of isolated eigenvalues of finite multiplicity. That's what we are going to discuss now. So in some cases, spectral properties of the Schrödinger-type operator can be reduced to the spectral properties of certain Schrödinger-type operator defined on a discrete ultrametric space. And I'm going to introduce this case. So first of all, let us consider association. Continuous model, discrete model. So consider family of dyadic partitions of the set of integers. So these are singletons. Next, we consider couples. And so on. We put together 2 points and then 4 points and so on. So we consider this family of dyadic partitions of the set of integers. And having these partitions, we can define hierarchical structure. The ultrametric, the set of balls, etc. Now we would like to construct discrete counterpart of the hierarchical Laplacian. So here we are. So we consider the so-called ball in the discrete ultrametric space. And consider hierarchical Laplacian associated with this discrete structure. You see, again, we take sum of pure jump generators. One can show that the operator L is a bounded symmetric operator having eigenvalues kappa raised to power r, where r greater or equal 1. So actually, we removed big jumps. We removed big jump, eigenvalues. We caught big eigenvalues from the big operator. So the corresponding eigenfunctions are discrete versions of Haar functions, as was defined in the previous case. Now, we would like to find discrete version of the potential. To do this, we want to consider special class of potentials, the so-called potentials of finite rank. So these are special potentials. You see, all bumps have the same structure. They are connected to the intervals of the same rank. Rank r equals to 0. And then we can define discrete version of such a potential of finite rank. These are delta functions concentrated at point I. And then we consider multiplication, operator of multiplication. It is easy to see that this multiplication operator can be written in this form. as a sum of one-dimensional operators. And now the association of Schrödinger operator and discrete Schrödinger operator is evident. So this is a counterpart, a discrete counterpart of our operator H. Now, why this association is so useful? Because L2 can be decomposed, can be split into orthogonal subspaces. So L minus is generated by Haar functions related to small intervals and indicators of big intervals. Evidently, these two subspaces are orthogonal in L2. And now splitting lemma reads as follows. So this is a representation of L2 as sum of two orthogonal subspaces. And next property that these subspaces reduce the operator H, symmetric operator H. And on small interval, the operator H is diagonalized by Haar functions and has eigenvalues. You see, you just add sigma I. But the operator H restricted to L plus can be identified with discrete version of the Schrödinger operator with this potential and with this operator. And now we would like to study this discrete model and to say something about spectrum. Because on L minus, everything is clear. The operator H restricted to L minus has pure point spectrum. All these eigenvalues, it has eigenvalues. And it depends on sigma I of these coefficients. You have to take closure of these numbers. Maybe you will get the whole interval. But anyway, H being restricted to L minus has pure point spectrum. What happens with H restricted to L plus? This is a good problem. And to consider this problem, I would like to say something about rank one perturbation, when in potential we have only one bump, only one sigma. So let's consider rank one perturbation. This is this perturbation. This is potential, and this is hierarchical operator. Well, actually, spectral theory of such operator is not trivial at all. It is not trivial at all. So in this section, let us assume that the ultrametric space is countably infinite. Because I explain you thanks to splitting lemma, everything can be reduced to the discrete case. And what we want is maybe to prove or disprove existence of absolutely continuous part of the spectrum, of singular continuous part of the spectrum. So this is question of Anderson. So in this case, X can be, the phase space can be identified with a countable abelian group. Well, this is very interesting observation. that if ultrametric space is countably infinite, then one can find a countable abelian group and my quantification. For instance, this group can be chosen as a weak sum of cyclic groups. Equipped with the sequence of its small subgroups, then each ball in this group is a coset. This is a topological trick. So we consider hierarchical Laplacian with rank one perturbation. Well, let us recall very general Simon-Wolf theorem about pure point spectrum of rank one perturbation of operators having simple spectrum. Here is definition. This is very general theorem. One says that a self-adjoint operator acting on a Hilbert space has a simple spectrum if there exists a vector phi, a cyclic vector, such that the set of these vectors is a total set in H. Now, the Simon-Wolf criterion. Let A be a self-adjoint operator with simple spectrum on a Hilbert space H, and let phi be a cyclic vector. Then by spectral theorem, H is unitary equivalent to L2 with respect to measure mu, probability measure mu, in such a way that A is a multiplication by X with cyclic vector phi equals to 1. Let us consider operator H sigma. A minus sigma is one-dimensional rank one perturbation. And let us consider this function. This is Borel-Steltiès transform of measure mu. Then theorem. Let us fix interval AB. The following properties are equivalent. H sigma has only pure point spectrum in the interval. Sigma almost everywhere. And Borel-Steltiès transform is finite in X, almost everywhere in X, in interval AB. This is very general theorem. So in general, this set is the closest subspace, the so-called cyclic subspace. And its orthogonal complement is an invariant space for H. And H equals A on this orthogonal complement. Therefore, the extension from the cyclic to non-cyclic case is clear. Now, in our case, the function, the delta function, is not a cyclic vector for L because the operator L has many compactly supported outside of A eigenfunctions. So we are not able directly to apply the Simon-Wolf theorem, but we can prove that the spectrum of this operator is pure point for all sigma. And for this, we use Grigor'yan-type identity. Here, R is a resolvent kernel for L, which can be computed explicitly, thanks we know spectrum of L. And RV, this is a resolvent kernel for perturbated operator. You see? This is so-called crane identity. So we see that there is denominator here, a sense to this denominator, spectrum becomes bigger. And this is solution to this equation. And here is theorem which describe spectrum of H sigma. So first of all, the spectrum of H sigma, thanks to Grigor'yan identity, is pure point for all sigma. And it consists of at most one negative eigenvalue and countably many positive eigenvalues. At most one negative eigenvalue. And if sigma is greater than zero, then H sigma has precisely one negative eigenvalue if one of the following condition holds. So the Markov semigroup is recurrent. That means that on the diagonal it is infinity at lambda equals to zero. By the way, this quantity does not depend on A. It can be computed explicitly. And there is one more case. The Markov semigroup is transient. But the value of R0 is greater than 1 over sigma. If sigma less than zero, then all eigenvalue of H sigma are positive. And there is one more eigenvalue lambda sigma plus. You see, between eigenvalues lambda k are eigenvalues of operator L. And between each eigenvalue appears new eigenvalue, which depends on sigma. And maybe one more. All eigenvalues lambda k have eigenfunctions which are compactly supported. And they have infinite multiplicity. But the eigenvalue lambda k sigma, this eigenvalue is a simple eigenvalue, has multiplicity one, and eigenfunction related to this eigenvalue is not compactly supported function. This is eigenfunction corresponding to eigenvalue lambda k sigma. So this is full picture in the case of rank one perturbations. So each bump add some eigenvalues between eigenvalues of operator L. Now, what happens if we have two, three, or more bumps? Well, in this case, asymptotic methods of spectral analysis shows that if distances between bumps increase to infinity, then each bump make its contribution independently to the spectrum. So we obtain the union of contributions. But what happens if we have infinitely many bumps? So if we have this operator, then this is so-called, then we have to apply our observation with finite dimensional perturbations. So this is theory which in classic case was developed by Pearson, Molchanov, Kiselev, Lass, Simon. So in our case, the result looks as following. Let us denote by sigma star the set of limit points of the sigmas, of the sequence of sigma I. And this set of the reciprocal, and this is set of solutions of the equation. So assume that sigma i's are in some fixed interval, and that distances between bumps fast enough go to infinity. Then essential spectrum of H can be computed precisely. This is spectrum of L plus infinitely many solution of such equations. I recall that R lambda resolvent kernel on the diagonal, this is meromorphic function. So we have to solve each time some equation. So we can describe essential spectrum of H, okay? But unfortunately, this theorem does not contain any information about absolutely continuous path and singular continuous path of the spectrum of H. Well, these paths are very hard to study. So our next theorem shows that under more restrictive assumptions than this one, these sets are in fact empty sets. So that means the spectrum of H is pure point. And moreover, we will show that eigenfunctions of H decay at infinity exponentially in certain ultrametric. This is a well-known property. It is called localization property, localization theorem. So we consider Schrodinger-type operator with random potential. And random potential, it has countably many bumps, and amplitudes are random variables. Amplitudes are random variables. Okay, and we assume that all balls BA have the same diameter. So that means that we can apply our splitting lemma and pass to the discrete model. So we can pass to the discrete model. Here is discrete counterpart. We assume that some technical assumptions, amplitudes are random variables, IID actually random variables, and they have densities. This case was when the set of location is the whole space. This theorem have been considered by Molchanov when sigma has Cauchy distribution, and later in slightly more general form by Krichevsky. And because the set of location is the whole set, so our potential has self-similarity property. And this is property is very essential to prove that the spectrum of H is pure point, omega almost everywhere. But we assume that instead, we assume that the set of locations very rare. So we assume that phi omega is a sparse potentials. Is a sparse potential. So this assumption destroy self-similarity property and allow us, does not allow us to apply ergodic theory. Instead, we apply Simon-Wolf, we apply our theorem about sparse potentials and Simon-Wolf theorem about pure point spectrum with some technique of fractional moments and so on, Borel-Cantelli type arguments. So this is our theorem. The operator H omega has pure point spectrum provided that almost everywhere has pure point spectrum omega almost sure. If this condition holds, you see, it's more strong condition. We consider some number R here. For sparse potential, R equals 1. And here we have to assume something more. And then we can prove that essential spectrum of H omega, which is pure point, and it consists of spectrum of L plus countably many intervals which do not intersect, and each interval can be written, can be defined as following. It is inside, it is in spectral gap between lambdas, and to find this interval, you have to solve this equation, where sigma is support of probability distribution. Where sum is support, sigma is support of probability distribution sigma, which is some small interval. So solution to this equation is some small interval inside of spectral gap. Okay. So I would like to mention here our joint paper in ArcSieve. This is a recent paper. So one can details find in this paper. It is available already on ArcSieve. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for a very interesting talk. Thank you. With so many interesting phenomena shown. So we have some, probably 2 minutes for questions. So please, if there are questions.
Okay. Thank you. Something about the physical applications, these models.
This is mathematical statistics, statistical mechanics, excuse me.
Okay. This a more concrete model.
Ferromagnetic model, Ising model of lattice gas.
Okay, thank you.
Ising model.
Thank you.
By what is the technique obtained the Anderson localization estimates?
First of all, this is heat kernel estimates of Schrödinger-type semigroup. Heat kernel estimates, Harnack inequality and so on, spectral analysis.
Okay, it is a different approach approach Anderson and approach the later the people who work the Anderson estimates?
No, we don't use this technique. We use our own technique, technique of heat kernel estimates.
Okay.
So first of all, find. First of all, we need to find spectrum. Second, we have to estimate eigenfunctions. Eigenfunctions. And to show that eigenfunctions exponentially decay in certain ultrametrics.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome. In the paper in ArcSieve, you can find this technique.
Okay.
You can find proofs. And so these are heat kernel estimates.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
One more question.
Can you state something, some analog, say, of Simon Wolf's theorem about the typical structure of spectra? So this is pure point, this is singular, under rank one perturbation. In your case.
Yes. As I told you. Wait a moment. This result about rank one perturbations. You see, this is complete solution to rank one problem. So each bump, I call rank one perturbation a bump. Each bump gives you a new eigenvalue in the spectral gap. Here we are. This is spectral gap, and each bump gives you one eigenvalue, and maybe one negative eigenvalue. And this is more or less simple simple investigation, because, as I told you, since you know spectral properties of operator L, you can compute more or less explicitly its reservoir kernel. This is a meromorphic function.
No, this I understand. I mean, is the situation when the spectrum is, say, purely singular continuous, not pure?
This is open question. This is open question. We unfortunately, we try to construct different models, different potentials, and to prove that, namely, in this case, we have absolutely continuous spectrum or singular continuous spectrum, but unfortunately, we did not succeed.
Okay, thank you very much.
Oh, this is an open question.
Thank you.
Okay, maybe thank you. A good problem for a PhD student.
Can I ask the question?
I'm afraid that we should continue with the next talk, because we should respect our schedule. Thank you very much once more.
Welcome.
So could you please unshare your screen?